Faith Matters. An interactive program brought to you by MTA International.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome to another edition of Faith Matters, where you, our viewers on MTA, set the agenda by the questions you ask. Jazakumullah and thank you for the questions you've been sending in, but just as a reminder right from the outset, for all our viewers, if you want to send in any comments, thoughts, questions or observations, the email address for the program is faithmatters@mta.tv. That's faithmatters, one word, at mta.tv. As some of you may know, you can actually find Faith Matters on the web now. Go to YouTube, MTA Online 1, Faith Matters, the name of the program, and put in the subject you're after, and hopefully you'll find the answer right there. And if not, you know what to do. faithmatters@mta.tv. With that, it's my absolute pleasure to welcome to Faith Matters two very eminent scholars and two good friends, and very good friends for that matter, of Faith Matters. It's always a pleasure to welcome to Faith Matters both these gentlemen. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Faith Matters.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
For the benefit of our viewers, both gentlemen I'm sure are well known to our viewers on MTA, but nevertheless, to my immediate right is of course Dr. Zayed Ahmed Khan Sahib. He's president of the Qazaa Board here in the United Kingdom. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Sahib.
Wa alaikum salam.
And to his right, we welcome to Faith Matters. It's a great pleasure to welcome the Amir of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Association in Ghana, Abdul Wahab Adam Saab. It's great to have you on the program again,
sir. Thank you very much indeed.
We're going to go to Africa for our first question. It comes from Gwanda Kuna in Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum and thank you for your question. A bit of a personal question, I suppose, comes from Gwanda, and it relates to marriages. And he asks the question, my friends often say that you have to start very early to pray for one's future spouse. I don't know why. He says that regrettably for him, it didn't come to mind to do so as well. And he says he now regrets it because he is now in his 20s and not married. So he said, if I start praying now, Wahab Saab, is it too late already?
No, it isn't late at all. And indeed, the parents also pray for the children.
Indeed.
Right from the beginning, when the children are being in the mother's wombs, even at that time, prayers are offered for them. And when they are in fact meeting for the conception to take place, that time too, Islam requires that parents should pray. So parents do pray for the children, and the children also pray for the parents. And according to the Holy Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, prayers that are said for children, as well as prayers that are said for parents, are generally accepted by the Almighty. So while all these prayers are going on, an individual should also be able to pray for himself or herself. And those who started a bit earlier have done the right thing. But if for any reason he couldn't start early enough, 28, it's not too late, and I think he can also pray for himself.
Plenty of years still for Gwanda there. And Dr. Saab, on the issue of prayers, Jazakumullah Wahab Saab, I think his second question is also about gratefulness to God or ungratefulness, and whether God himself forgives that. But linking that into the concept of prayers, again, when one's praying for one's spouse, you know, you look for certain qualities. So if you're a man looking for, you know, praying for your future wife, there are specific qualities that the Holy Prophet of Islam also said that one should seek out in one's future partner as well. Perhaps you could touch on those as well.
Absolutely. I mean, the whole essence of prayer, prayer in Islam, prayer for a Muslim, as Wahab Saab has said, are very important things. And this is a journey, this is a process that continues throughout the life of man as he passes it. And during the course of our daily life, in fact, we have our daily salat, our daily prayers. And those prayers which have been taught to us by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was his practice, is something that we attach our importance to, and we do pray in that respect. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina azabannar. Grant us the good of this world. Now that is a very wide, all-encompassing prayer. And when you think about it, the life that we have here of having a partner does actually come within that prayer as well. That is the good, that is the paradise within our homes that we are praying for, and praying for a partner who will actually join with us in that journey is something important. So in essence, you are already praying for that spouse as well in that prayer. But when the subject of a spouse is discussed, the Holy Prophet, as you have said that man should choose a wife not only for such and such a reason, but he has given four reasons. And he has said some choose them for their family, some choose them because of their wealth, some choose them because of their beauty, and some choose them because of their piety. And he said that you should always give piety the precedence when you are choosing a wife. So in that respect, you should pray that Allah grants you a wife who is pious for first and foremost and has all the other attributes and qualities as well. So that is what we should be praying for, is a spouse who will actually, we can continue this journey together and be more righteous as far as our whole journey of life is concerned. As far as the subject of gratefulness, that is something that is very important for us in Islam as well, and ungratefulness on the opposite hand is something that we tend to try to stay clear of. God says that man is weak, he tends to err and he tends to make mistakes and he tends to be ungrateful for all the things that he has been granted. So that is human nature, that he is ungrateful at times. But for man to realize how he has been ungrateful and then to reform himself is the important issue there. So you must be aware of where you have and how you have been ungrateful to God Almighty for whatever He has granted you in this life. That Allah grants us so much even without asking for it. He is the most merciful, He is the most beneficent, and He gives us some things without asking, and some things He gives us by us praying to Him. So man should always be grateful for all of those things that have been provided for us by Allah in that respect. Allah says, "La in shakartum la azidannakum, wa la in kafartum inna azabi lashadid." If you are grateful to me for what I have given you, I will keep on blessing you even more. But if you're ungrateful, my punishment is severe. But at the same time, we know of the mercy of Allah. That when a Muslim turns to Allah with true repentance and is aware that he is going to reform himself and that in future he will be grateful, then Allah obviously always forgives, because that is in the nature of Allah. He is the most forgiving. So he will always forgive man for the mistakes that he makes, as long as that repentance is true from the heart and man really reforms himself, that he sees a pious change in his character. And that is what Allah wants of us. So the connection with Allah through our prayers is an important aspect of a Muslim's life. And for us to be grateful to God Almighty for whatever He has granted us is something that man needs to be doing at all the time, and be aware of that.
Gentlemen, Jazakumullah for your very detailed answers, and my thanks go to Gawanda as well. And I'm sure in the responses you've heard, Gawanda, you have your answer. So it's never too late, and certainly when prayer is concerned, prayer is always there, and Allah is all forgiving as well. So always bear that in mind. And you know what, as a final word, being in your 20s, you've still got many good years ahead of you. We'll move on to our next question. We're sticking with the African continent. This comes from the from Asani Yaya from the Bangui, from the Republic of Central Africa. Wahab Saab, he's asking a question that related to, he's heard that the Holy Prophet of Islam, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, said 124,000 prophets Allah will send in the world. And he wants to know whether this concerns all the prophets till the Day of Judgment, or is it only all previous prophets?
Well, it's a figure that the Holy Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, has given. But it tells you the largeness of the prophets and reformers, as well as the sages who have been sent by the Almighty from time to time in man's history for the guidance of man. What is important here to note is the Holy Quran tells us in clear terms, وَهِمْ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَىٰ خَلَىٰ فِيهَا نَذِيرٌ. There hasn't been any nation amongst whom God has not sent a warner. So they could be as many as that, they could even be more than that, but it's an idea to give to people that God has not abandoned anybody. Mm-hmm. All those that He has created are His beloved children, and He wouldn't let them go astray without any guidance. In fact, God says He has taken upon Himself the responsibility of granting guidance to man. And so I think the figure that is given is only to give us an idea about the large-heartedness of the Almighty, His grace and His beneficence, that He has not left any people at all without guidance. Otherwise, generally people feel that, you see, it is possible that God sent prophets to the Israelites and nobody else. And sometimes God sent prophets maybe to the Arabs and to nobody else. But if He tells you that figure, it tells you that it's not limited to any one people. It's a large number of prophets. So that's the idea that I believe the number is to convey. And it is to let us understand how gracious the Almighty God, Almighty Allah, is to His creatures, that He has created us for a purpose, and He is making sure that the purpose is also attained. And to attain that, He's sending guides, He's sending prophets, sending messengers who keep warning us and admonishing us and guiding us on the straight path.
Just as an added point on this, I suppose, as a sort of question that comes from this, Doksav, is also, Asani is also alluding to the fact on, you know, the finality of the Holy Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him, in the sense that, is this something that, is revelation going to continue until the Day of Judgment, or as some argue, well, it all ended at the time of the Holy Prophet of Islam, and that no one thereafter could come who would be carrying revelations or put forward revelations as revealed to them from God?
You see, this revelation is the form in which God Almighty talks to His people. And if we believe that there is a living and self-sustaining God, that He spoke in the past, then there is no doubt that He can still speak in the present and in the future to His people, to His chosen ones. So that is something that we have to understand from the subject of God Almighty and His attributes in that respect. What we know is that there has been an evolution of the guidance and teachings that have come through these 124,000 prophets. And the final law-bearing prophet that was sent with the final message of God Almighty was the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam of Islam. So from that point onwards, there can be no new guidance that can be sent to man, since the best and the final law has already been revealed. So as far as revelation of new guidance is concerned, that cannot happen. But God, as was prophesied by the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that God will raise a prophet who will be a reflection of me, who will rejuvenate Islam and other faiths. And that is what we believe, that God has, through the promised Messiah alayhi salam, who was raised as a prophet, a non-law-bearing prophet in that sense, and was able to bring about the renaissance of Islam. So as God spoke before, He continues to speak and reveal Himself in many ways to His creation and to man in general.
You see, the truth is, if God does not speak today, what is the guarantee that He also sees today? These are attributes of God. They cannot be suspended in any way at all whatsoever. They are continuous. And so if you read the Quran, God talks about الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُوا عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا. Those who say that our God is Allah, ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا, and then they remain steadfast. تَتَنَزَّلُوا عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ, angels descend upon them. And when the angels descend upon them, do they not say anything? أَلَّا تَخَافُوا, the angels tell them from God that you should not fear and you should not have any grief. You see, so it means that, you know, conversation with the Almighty, in fact, that is one of the proofs of the existence of God. And that is also one of the proofs of the communion between God and mankind. So if that is cut off, then it means that our belief even in God would be shaking. Mm-hmm. And besides, the Holy Prophet of Islam, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, had come in order, as our brother was saying, to elevate us to the position when we will say that we have reached the top of, you know, religious evolution. And now if after that God is no longer speaking to anybody, then it means that we are going backwards and not forward.
To sustain that Gentlemen, Jazakumullah, and also my thanks goes to Asani Yaya for your question as well. We're going to come straight back home for our next question, which comes from Rashid Ahmed Sahib. Thank you and for your question, Rashid Sahib, and assalamu alaikum to yourself as well. And thank you for your kind words about faith matters. He's talking about a grave subject, sorry, I know it's a pun, but he's asking about the living dead or the raising of the dead. And his question relates to, some say that the dead will be raised from their graves on the Day of Judgment. In what form will they be woken up or raised after death? We've previously had questions on faith matters relating to zombies and about people being physically ascending from their graves. But when people are taught or is said that on the Day of Judgment people will be raised from their graves, what does that actually mean?
Well, this certainly does not mean that they will be raised in the physical body that they were buried in at that time, but it refers to a form, a spiritual form, in which mankind will be raised for the Day of Judgment. In fact, the Holy Quran is clear on this subject of whether this will be physical or something that we don't know not. In Surah Al-Waqi'ah it says, وَنُنْشِيَكُمْ فِي مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. So it is, you will be raised in a state of which you have no knowledge at present. So this is God Almighty saying that the body that you were buried in will not be the body that you will be raised up in. So many Muslims actually do believe that that is not the case, that people will be raised up in the physical body that we have here on this earth. That would be quite a scenario, because there are people who are disabled physically, there are people who are lame, toothless. There are people toothless, there are people who are blind, there are some who die young, some who die very old, and these are the bodies that they were buried in. So if they were raised up in that same state, then what will be the scenario of the paradise that some, they will still have their disabilities in that sense. In fact, this was beautifully brought to mind by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he gave a great scenario. An old woman approached him in Medina and she said, O Prophet of Allah, will I also be in paradise with you? And the Prophet, in a sense, in a jovial sense, said to her, no, there will be no old woman in paradise. And she was very much taken aback by this, you know, what was going to happen. And he said, the thing is that there will be no one in an old elder, in that sense, the physical body, that you will not be an old person in that, but you will be raised up in a form that you have no knowledge, meaning that it will be a spiritual soul that will be raised, not the physical body, so you will not have the reflection of an old person at that stage, but everybody will be on the level par at that time, and it will be a spiritual sense in that sense. So that demonstrates to us clearly that it is not a physical raising of the dead from the graves, but it is a spiritual sense that people will be raised up by Allah the Almighty in that sense at that time.
Yes. And as I said, you know, man is made of not only bones and blood and flesh, also of the soul. And so when there is death, there is a separation
between the physical and the spiritual.
Now the soul is now going to be given another body.
Okay.
For the raising of the dead. And the way it goes is, whatever we do on earth, whatever we say on earth, whatever act that we perform, all those are made to form a sort of body that will be made to clothe the soul for the body to be raised spiritually. And so that is why it is so important that we should not just be looking at this present world. We should also be looking at how the soul is going to be given a special body for the raising of the dead. And if we understand that it is going to be determined by the good deeds and good intentions and the service that we render and the worship that we do to the Almighty, all those are what are going to form the body of the soul, as a result of which, on the Day of Judgment, it will be raised. So that's going to be spiritual.
Gentlemen, Jazakumullah for that, and Rashid Ahmed Saab, thank you for your question as well. We're going to travel to the USA for our next question, which comes from Mukhtar Mahmoud Saab. He gives a bit of a confession at the start. He said he's only recently started listening and watching to Faith Matters, but he sort of recovers himself by saying that he's enjoying it immensely. So Jazakumullah Mukhtar Sahib, and thank you for your question. Interesting question, very removed from our previous questions we've had. Why doesn't the Ahmadiyya Muslim community form a political party to promote peace in the world and accelerate the efforts to save the community from persecution in various countries? Two elements to the question, I suppose. One relates to a religious organization such as the Ahmadiyya Muslim community becoming a political organization. And secondly, how you can tackle the issue of persecution, which is something which is prevalent, unfortunately, against the community, indeed other communities as well in parts of the world. Well, Habsab, if I could come to you. We often say religion and politics shouldn't mix.
It is natural for somebody who doesn't understand the dynamics of religion to feel that if there is a community that is so dedicated to the cause of mankind, and it's being so severely and so terribly persecuted, why can't it convert itself into a political party which will have the power as well as the authority to say, hey, you know, enough is enough? But religion doesn't work that way. We know about the Holy Prophet of Islam, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He was raised amongst people who did not understand in the beginning the profundity of the message that he brought, and so opposed him very, very, brutally. But that did not make him form a political party. He remained a religious community because we believe that these things are decreed by the Almighty himself. God himself has sent a messenger, a prophet, and he's given him a duty to perform. And now, according to the Holy Quran, it says, "La aqlabanna." Anna wa rusuli, I will be victorious, myself and my prophet, which means that the victory of the prophet is the victory of God, and the victory of Allah is reflected in the victory of the prophet. So he himself is going to make sure that he is not vanquished, and so you don't actually require a political party to do that. And our, you know, history bears clear testimony to it. There have been powerful, you know, rulers in different parts of the world who have tried to suppress us. But without any effort on our part, apart from prayers and supplications to the Almighty, a lot of things begin to happen. And they happen in such miraculous way that people begin to wonder what is happening. I mean, we can cite so many examples, but the example of Bhutto is very clear to all of us. He sat on his throne and said, look, my seat is very, very solid. And as a result of that, he thought that he was so powerful, could do whatever he pleased with us. And we all know what he has done to us. This is not the time to explain it in detail. But you see, when the time came for God to show his power to him, that he is more powerful than he is, the whole world were trying to save him by appealing to the then government or the ruler of the time that should spare him the ordeal of being hanged. And so it came from almost all the various religious communities, from Christian communities, from Islamic communities, from the Arabs, from the non-Arabs, from Europe, from America. All these were done, but he couldn't save himself. So we believe that if it is the community of the Almighty, then he himself will take care of it. Ours is to continue to serve mankind as best as humanly possible, as best as we are taught to do. Theirs is to try to listen and maybe to understand us. If they understand us, well and good. If they think that they will be bent upon vanquishing the community of the Almighty, then we leave it in the hands of the Almighty, like it happened in Lahore after the slaughter of our members in the mosque. The leader of the community there was asked, what do you want the government to say? We don't want it. We don't require anything from anybody. What we know is it's the community of God, and himself will take care of it. So I believe that superficially, somebody might think that maybe the best option is to form a political party. But from the history of religions, that's not the best option.
Jazakumullah. Well, so for that very detailed answer and comprehensive one as well. Dr. Saab, just this issue as a sort of final point for all viewers' clarification about Yamdia Muslim community itself, that it operates very much in an apolitical way, i.e. non-political way, and there's no sort of alignment to any party. Sometimes it's suggested that in different parts of the world mm-hmm. that the community may have aligned itself, but that's certainly not the case, and the community remains very much engaged in bringing about change, as Wahab Saab has said, but through its own demonstration of what it can do in terms of humanity and service to humanity.
Yeah, the Jamaat has throughout the world never had any political aspirations, and that is why in every part of the world the Jamaat has never formed a political party or shown any alliances to any particular party either. But at the same time, we are members of the worldwide community in different parts of the world, and as members of the indigenous population, we too obviously try our best to bring about change for also all different factions of society who we think are oppressed and going through problems. And this is the humanitarian side of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community worldwide, that we do our utmost and our best as a community to try to ease the suffering and problems of all minorities and all factions of society who undergo these problems. But at the same time, it should also be borne in mind that as individual Ahmadis, we are always have the ability to take part in politics if we do so, wish to do so as an individual. And there cannot be a better example than Lord Ahmad himself, because that is something that members of the Ahmadiyya community throughout the world do, and they take part in political parties. Whichever political party is closer to their heart, they have that option to follow that and to try to bring about a change within, in trying to take the ideals of Islamic teachings to the world so that people can realize the beauty of the teaching and try to bring about change from that sort of an angle. So in that respect, the Ahmadis throughout the world continue in this struggle and continue with the utmost to try to bring about peaceful change for humanity and for mankind as such. And it is not only for the Muslims. This has to be emphasized, that the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat is something that takes on the problems of the whole of humanity, irrespective of color, creed, faith, whatever. And therefore, we are always at the forefront whenever there is some problem throughout the world. Not only as individuals, but our Khalifa as well brings to the attention of the world the problems that are existing and the solutions to that, and bringing world leaders together to bring about this change. So this is our aim and this is our effort, that we want to bring about peace in the world through those types of efforts.
And since he mentions Lord Tariq, that is the current. But we have people like, say, Muhammad Zafrullah Khan, who was the first foreign minister of Pakistan, and he was appointed by the founder of Pakistan himself. Mm-hmm. And he served the country very, very well. India was already on the world map, but not Pakistan. So he had to struggle to get Pakistan on the world map. And then through the services that he rendered at the United Nations, he also served a number of Muslim countries, especially those in Northern Africa and so on.
Indeed.
So it tells you that individual members of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community are encouraged by the community to give of their best to their nation, so far as political organization is concerned. I remember Sheikh Amr Abedi, who used to be in Tanzania. Mm. He studied as a missionary in Rabwa, but after his studies, he was, you know, the Nyerere, who was the then president, requested the second Khalifa to release him to assist him in the organization of his political party. And he was released. And after that, he became the first mayor of Dar es Salaam. And then he later became Minister of Justice and so on. So in those capacities, he served his country very, very well politically. But that is an individual effort. And the more Ahmadis will come into the fray, the more they will be serving mankind in that aspect too. But we are not looking at a situation when the community as a community forms a political party.
Before we move on, just both of you alluded to specifics in terms of service to humanity. We have our own international charitable organization called Humanity First, which does exactly what it says on its label, that puts humanity first. But if we could sort of take Africa, for example, Wahab Saab, Ghana is a good example, but other parts as well. The Yamdia Muslim community there is demonstrable and recognizable by what it does in the community. Mm-hmm. And coming back to what our questioner asked, through that spirit, through education, through social service, actually does foster peace and reconciliation as well.
That is true. Yes, I mean, in Ghana, for instance, like in quite a number of other countries mm-hmm. of the world, mm-hmm. we run schools, we run hospitals, and the example that we give is, it is for the entire community. We are not building school because we want Muslims alone to study. We are not building hospitals because we want Muslims alone to be given the cure. And the example we set is such that even Christians who come to our schools rise to become moderators of Christian churches, which means that nobody is being coerced and nobody is being compelled to leave his or her religion and join Islam. If they so please, well and good. If they are not, nobody compels them. And they themselves admit that the harmony that exists between Christianity or Christians and Muslims started from this, you know, experience that they had. As Christians, they went to Muslim schools, they interacted with Muslims, Muslims interacted with them, they saw some of the beauties of Islam, and then we also saw some of the beauties of Christianity. That has allowed for interreligious cooperation and harmony, yeah. And that is a very great service also to the nation.
Yeah, I mean, the just to highlight the medical camp, because that's something closer to my heart as well. The Jamaat runs these eye camps. You know, the sight appeals are out there. So cataract operations in Africa, if you go out there, the cataracts become very dense and people are blind. And such a simple operation in this country, which could be done, and that is what the Humanity First actually fosters. And then there are other medical camps that are run, and the Water for Life projects. You know, without water, as you know, there can be no life. And the community, the Humanity First was set up by the fourth Khalifa, may Allah be pleased with him. But it has been taken on to a new dimension by our present Imam, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Al-Khamis, in that he has got this village projects in Africa, where the entire village is set up by the community, and schools and hospitals and water wells and electricity and solar power are all being brought. These things that we in the West take for granted are being brought into these remote villages by Humanity First through the projects, is something that is remarkable and shows actually the humanitarian side of mankind and humanitarian side of the Jamaat in particular in that respect.
And this model village that you talk about is also important in one sense, that people will then see that village as a model in case they want, even if the government wants to replicate them, they could be replicated, because otherwise you go to a village and there is no electricity there. Then you go to a village, you don't have means of, you know, convenience and things. Mm-hmm. You go to a village, there's no school there. Mm-hmm. You go to a village and there's no water, potable water for people to drink. Now, if we have one village which is now organized as a model village, then the advantage is we begin to understand that it's not only those people in the urban areas who require electricity, and who require education, who require health care, mm-hmm. and so on. Mm-hmm. And so that can be replicated in other parts of the country. So in that sense, again, it is a very, very important contribution to the people.
Gentlemen, jazakumullah for your very detailed answers, and my thanks also to Mukhtar Saab from the US for your question. For our next question, we go to Germany and to Hamburg, to Bashir Khan Sahib. Assalamu alaikum, Bashir Saab. Thank you for your question. He's been having recent discussions about the whole issue of taqdeer, predestiny, fate. And he then is asking a question, which, to be fair, a lot of people of no faith, agnostics, atheists, often raise this. They say, well, if as people of faith you believe in predestination, you believe that, you know, things have already been written, God's already decided what's going to happen, what's the point of life at all? What's the point of going that extra mile? What's the point of making that extra effort to change things around? And surely it's all, is it sheer luck? Is it potluck that things happen? And he also then goes on to say that some people are born into affluent families, some people are born into poverty. But you know what? They can't do anything about it because that's their fate. So what's actually meant by this whole issue of predestiny and fate? Wahab Sahib, if I could start with you.
I have a feeling that it is only one of the attributes of the Almighty, that he knows what goes on all over the world. And having created the world from the beginning, would know everything. But that knowledge does not compel us to do anything different. See, because his knowledge is not made to compel us to do anything in any special direction. So what we are saying is, it is the Almighty who determines, it is the Almighty who knows everything that is going on now, that went on before, that will come later. But that does not prevent us from doing what we are expected to do. Because if that knowledge would have somehow crippled us in any way, then of course it becomes a deterrent, it becomes a way of keeping us backward. But if that knowledge does not interfere in what we are doing, because God does not use that knowledge to interfere in what we are doing, it's just like a student in a class, you know, who is very, very brilliant. Mm. And the teacher knows that here is somebody who is definitely going to pass. Mm. So if somebody tries also to study as hard as that person, who is known by the teacher to be intelligent, he will also be equally intelligent and also pass. Mm. But if he feels that because the teacher says he is intelligent and so he's going to do nothing, then of course he will gain nothing. So I think that is how it is. We are only trying to let people know that it is God who created the world. It is God who created mankind. He knows what he has created. He has full control over that. But that does not preclude our right as well as the privilege of going our own way the way we want. And then as for people being born in big homes or small homes, those are things that nobody can actually have any control over. But what is important is we know of people who are born in small homes or not that affluent and yet strive to become one of the greatest people in that country or in fact in the world. So here again, what is important is for us to persevere and then use all the faculties that God has given to us to do what is expected of us as human beings, while we leave God to do what he is to do as the creator. Both of them do not conflict in any way at all whatsoever.
So effort, I mean, and it's interesting you talked about the analogy of the intelligent and the person perceived not as intelligent sitting the exam, but equally it applies that if the intelligent person sits back and says, well, I'm intelligent or perceived as such, but I'm not going to study, he or she will then fail. You know, and I'm sure there's instances which have occurred in that respect as well. Jazakumullah Wahab Sahib for your answer to that, and my thanks also to Bashir Khan Sahib from Hamburg in Germany. I'm going to move on to a few other questions. Our next one comes from Vakar Ahmed in Canada. Assalamu alaikum, Vakar Sahib. Thank you for your question. Again, thank you also, as other viewers have done, for your kind comments about Faith Matters. As I say from my outset, Faith Matters is really down to our viewers and the questions you send in. So thank you for your question as well. He's been following, as many do now, we live in a social media world, lots of things sort of engulf us almost on a daily basis through the social media. But he's been following various media sites. And his question is quite specific, and he wants clarification on this issue. You have a married couple who are living their life. They find Islam, they're introduced to Islam, they research Islam. They study Islam and it gets to the point where they feel that they wish to accept Islam and join the fold of Islam, and they are welcomed into the fold of Islam. What happens then? It's come across some social media sites, Wahab Sahib, on this, whereby he's heard muftis of many different Muslim sects saying, well, you have to get remarried, you have to have a nikah performed again, you have to sort of restate your vows in an Islamic context.
You see, the religion of Islam is led by the Prophet of Islam, and he also gets his enlightenment from the Almighty himself. So during the time that he became a prophet, and only peace and blessings of Allah, there were people were converted, companions of the Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some of them were already married, but we don't find a single hadith anywhere in the world which says that the Holy Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, required them to renew their marriage because they had become Muslims. And so, if he is a best exemplar, uswatun hasana, then we have to take it from there. If the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, did not require his companions to renew their marriages because they had become Muslims, what is the need to do it now?
There was no mass nikah ceremony for all running. As I forget which community it is, which Moonies often have these marriage vows. So, I mean, that's quite clear, but we do find, Rukhsar, as well, that there's no place for it in Islam. Indeed, we're led, as we should be, by the noble example of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. But yet you do, unfortunately, you do find these... people who perceive themselves as muftis, it's a very polite term, because mufti, again, is a very noble term used for people who have great wisdom, have great knowledge of Islam and Islamic practice. Yet here they are suggesting such things as has being suggested by Vakar Saab across the social media. And someone would be quite perplexed, you know, someone's married, they've got, I don't know, 2, 3, 4 children, and suddenly they're being told, you have to sort of, I mean, many do restate their vows, but that's down to personal choice. Where do they get these ideals from?
These muftis, as you say, rightly, they are the scholars, and despite the fact that they do not find any substance in Hadith or the Holy Quran to substantiate that, but they do come out with these edicts which are very mind-boggling and difficult to understand. And even the children of such marriages they pronounce as illegitimate for whatever reason. Simply, the nikah is just a public announcement. That's what the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has advised us. It is a public announcement that the whole community should know that this person has been married to this person. And it's interesting that the verses of the Holy Quran that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam selected for the pronouncement of the nikah, the first of those verses, it says, "Ya ayyuhan nas ittaqu rabbakumul ladzi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida." Ya ayyuhan nas, O people, O mankind. It doesn't even reflect O Muslims. So this brings to point that it is an addressing to the whole of mankind, that we, not only to Muslims, that this marriage is taking place. So in whichever custom, whichever society you live in, if a marriage has been pronounced and accepted by that culture or by that society, then that is accepted by Islam to be a valid marriage as well. So as Muslims who before they, or for those converts who were married before, and the society recognized that this was a true marriage of these people, then Islam also recognizes that marriage is true. And the nikah, as Wahab Sahib has rightly said, does not have to be pronounced again. And the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not on any occasion pronounce the nikah of someone who had accepted Islam. So this is the background to that, and we are not quite sure where they find their background to, but that is totally contrary to the teachings of Islam and of the practice of the Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
You describe the Mufti as a very noble person, and that is how it should be, really, because here is somebody who must study the Holy Quran, who must study the traditions, who must know the spirit of Islam, and then try to, you know, present it to the world. Unfortunately, it's one of the challenges of Islam today, and the Holy Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, had predicted it, that a time will come when people will not be acting upon the teachings of Islam. And there is even a saying that when the Mahdi alayhi salatu wasalam comes, it will come at a time when faith would have, you know, disappeared from the earth. And so you have these ulama, scholars, who would not be acting in accordance with the teachings of the Quran. And in fact, sometimes out of the various sectarian divisions that has come into Islam. You have got pockets of these scholars, and each speaks against the other, which is very, very sad. And that is why sometimes these edicts come about. But if you go into it and you measure it with the Quran and the Hadith, you will see that it is completely hollow and has no foundation at all whatsoever.
JazakAllah, gentlemen, for your answers on that. It's just a reflection that I think the social media has now enabled. Perhaps there are people who don't really carry the mantle of being a mufti in reality, but present themselves as such, and there's a lot of information out there. Indeed, there's instances we hear whereby people who, according to these muftis, have fallen foul of their interpretation of Islam, who are Muslims themselves, and they almost then give out edicts saying, right, you fell out on our teaching, or so-called what we perceive to be the correct teaching, and your nikah now needs to be performed again. So this is to Muslims, in actual fact, you know, Muslims who they perceive have fallen short of their teachings, and they should actually re-perform their nikah to their wives, you know.
The breaking of a nikah for these muftis is very mundane and everyday matter. As you say, if they don't agree with their interpretation of Islam or whatever matter, then they have fallen outside the that thinking, and therefore it's the nikah that is at jeopardy, and it's the nikah that falls foul. So this is something that Islam does not teach, and nikah obviously cannot break on a matter like that. And as you know, the talaq or the khula are two things that can be done to break a nikah, and nothing of accepting the view of a mufti or his guidance on a certain matter that does not break the nikah.
Self-assumed kind of authority which is taken on board. Gentlemen, JazakAllah for your answers, and we've reached the end of this particular program on Faith Matters, and my thanks also go to our viewers. Without you, this program would not be what it is. Just as a final reminder, if I may, for all our viewers, new and old, indeed, Mukhtar Saab, you're probably now, we're going to count as an old viewer because you've been watching Faith Matters before. Email address for any comments, thoughts, observations, or questions you may have is faithmatters@mta.tv. That's faithmatters@mta.tv. Gentlemen, Wahab Saab, Dr. Zaid Saab, thank you once again for your answers, and my viewers, thanks to you. Until the next time from all of us on Faith Matters here in London. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.